Gee, thanks, WWE. And YouTube. You're amazing. Absolutely amazing.
Greetings, I'm Mr. Spiffy, and welcome to the Bottom of the Barrel. And it is time once again for grading your output. Today, I will be grading the output of WWE SummerSlam, the 25th annual SummerSlam. Not the 25th anniversary. I don't care what they say, because it would have made that the first SummerSlam was... It's stupid wording, but that's what they called it. The 25th anniversary of SummerSlam. For the third year in a row, SummerSlam is emanated from the Staples Center in Los Angeles. And as far as all information is going, it will emanate from the Staples Center in Los Angeles again next year. So, who knows, maybe I'll get a chance finally to go attend. The card itself definitely was not a big steaming pile of donkey crap like the last pay-per-view Money in the Bank. But was it terrible? No. No, this pay-per-view was like watching tidal waves. Sometimes they crested really high, and then other times it just sort of went down low. And I think that had a lot to do with the booking decisions that were made tonight, because the audience had moments where they were really into it and they were really high and a lot of energy, and then it just sort of petered out. I think if maybe they had kind of set the matches a little differently, the audience might have had more energy. But let's go over the matches in general. We started off on the pre-show. As you saw from my little clip at the beginning there, the little problem I had getting tuned into the pre-show, thank you to... a member of the Shut Up and Wrestle group who was nice enough to get me a quick link elsewhere where I could see the pre-show where Santino Marella defended the United States Championship against Antonio Cesaro. Starting me off 1-0 for SummerSlam, Antonio Cesaro became the new United States Champion. This matchup was mediocre at best. A lot of it was Santino madly trying to get to his lost Cobra, and at one point, Cesaro tore up the Cobra, and Santino apparently had another one shoved up his ass. You could tell because he sniffed it first. And this matchup, you know, I was happy to the end. I was counting the 1-2-3. As much as I like Santino as a general whole, I find him entertaining. I do find a lot of his antics funny. The United States Championship is just too prestigious of a title to be on a man like Santino for that length of time. It's hard to buy into him being one of the top four guys in the company, because the United States title is technically one of the top four belts in the company. So it left me a little bit there. I don't know how long they'll have the belt on Antonio, especially because he hasn't exactly had the most uber solid push leading up to this title change. But if the WWE continues its trend of keeping titles on champions for a long period of time, I'm hoping that his character will improve, and the man formerly known as Claudio Castagnoli will be able to show exactly why he was one of the longest reigning Ring of Honor tag team champions in history. This match, I give it a C. It was average, like I said, mediocre at best. The pay-per-view opened. We started off with Jericho versus Ziggler. I said it to Jericho on Twitter, I said it to a lot of people, I don't understand why they opened with this match. I know that they wanted to start strong for SummerSlam, and for starting strong, this is definitely a strong start match. However, I think this was the first big mistake of the night, and it was only a big mistake because it put the audience way up here, and then everything sort of went down. There was a couple moments where it peaked, but for the most part, it was pretty downhill from there, and I predicted that early on Twitter, for those of you who followed me on Twitter during it, at Mr. Spiffy, and I spent most of that time, you know, just going over. Now, the match itself, while I can't say that this match met that high standard that we all thought it was going to meet, it certainly was one of the best matches on the card. Did it steal the show? Came pretty darn close. I would say that these guys had a great back and forth. There was a wonderful technical aspect. We had each guy kick out of their main power finisher. The match ended with Jericho using the Lion Tamer version of the Walls of Jericho to make Ziggler tap out. This was definitely a high-quality match. I have to give it a solid A-. I would say that if given maybe about 5-10 more minutes, there was so much more false finishes and stuff they could have given this matchup, especially considering that the pay-per-view still ended with about 15 minutes left to spare. From there, from that matchup, we went on to a backstage segment with Triple H talking to referee Scott Armstrong and telling him that I don't want any DQs in this match. I don't want any countouts. This has got to be a fight to the finish. I know about referee's discretion. Let us fight. This was okay, but kind of boring moment. And I think the funniest part that came out of it was Shawn Michaels pretty much saying that Scott Armstrong, who didn't say word one, needed to shut his yap and let him do it. Oh, I'm sorry. That was on the pre-show. I'm sorry. There was another backstage segment with, I think it was Brock Lesnar. Heyman did most of the talking. Lesnar talked for a moment and corpsed for the camera. Fortunately, Lesnar didn't talk long and he didn't say much. Man can't talk worth crap. I think I'm going to forget mentioning the backstage segment, especially because none of them were all that memorable, and just move on through the matches. You had, from there, Kane versus Daniel Bryan. This was my first incorrect prediction, with Daniel Bryan rolling up Kane in a small package to get the 1-2-3. The nice thing about this is, at least the setup was more or less how I said it was. That, you know, I had said that Kane would capitalize on a mistake Daniel Bryan made. In this case, Bryan had pissed off Kane, and Bryan took advantage of a mistake that Kane made, trying to go ahead and do the tombstone instead of chest, pinning Daniel Bryan after the choke slam. And this matchup, it was below average for, I can't say below average, it was okay. I would say C+, maybe. It wasn't quite in the B range. I think that they could have done better. The audience was at least somewhat into it. We got some decent pops. The audience was amazing during Jericho versus Ziggler. So they were coming down off of that high, but they hadn't yet lost their stride. However, the time that they did lose their stride was in the next match, the Intercontinental Championship match of Rey Mysterio versus The Miz. And the audience was so quiet to the point that Miz was trying to pump up the audience. Rey Mysterio came out in one of his costumes, this time dressed as the Batman. So, na-na-na-na-na-na-na, Bat-Ray. And, this one was, I think they could have done better. I think they could have done worse. If I had to give it a rating, I would also say this match was pretty mediocre, and the audience didn't help with it. This was, with a borderline C-. It wasn't quite making the grade, and the fact that the heel in the match was really trying to get the audience involved was a big sign that there was just not chemistry there, or the audience just didn't care. The problem was, this match was announced via Twitter in the middle of Raw and was mentioned as a blurb randomly by Michael Cole, and then they had one match to build it on SmackDown. So nobody gave two flying fucks about it. You then went on to the next match on the card, which was the World Heavyweight Championship match. Fourth official match on the main pay-per-view, and we got the World Heavyweight title. Wow. That says an awful lot. So, Sheamus taking on Alberto Del Rio. This match was better than I thought it would be. It wasn't entirely a piece of shit. Sheamus won. That was no big surprise. I knew it was going to happen. No cash in by Ziggler. But the ending was extremely lame. The ending was a heel finish for the babyface. And I know that it's different than what usually would happen, but let's take a look at the factors. steal a car, plus go ahead and wipe your opponent's foot off the ropes so the referee doesn't see that he had his foot on the ropes during the count is considered a babyface. That one goes over my head a little bit. Maybe they're trying to make Sheamus a bit more of a tweener because he's not entirely getting over with the WWE audience. I don't know. What I can say is that ending just kind of came out of nowhere. I don't even think the timekeeper realized the match was over, like, because there was like a 5-7 second delay before he finally rang the bell. Like, he was sitting there going, wait, his foot was on the ropes. Why is the match ending? And, even the frickin' Mark Eaton saw it. And they had to go with that. Alright. Whatever. So Sheamus retains the World Heavyweight Championship. Yay, Sheamus. The downside is this probably means we'll have Sheamus versus Alberto number 3 at Night of Champions. Woo, sign my ass up. At least I didn't pay for the pay-per-view. Okay. We then have the Tag Team Championship match. Which was kind of like, finally, that happened on the card. The tag team champions, R-Truth and Kofi Kingston, taking on the team of the primetime players, Darren Young and Titus O'Neil. This matchup, I've seen them fight each other before, and this was not their best match. The audience was a bit more into it than they were with the previous two matches. The audience was pretty dead during most of the world title match. They built up a little bit more towards the end of the world title match, but not so much that it was really amazing and strong. But the tag champs and the tag match at least brought the audience a little bit more back to life. And in the end, R-Truth and Kofi Kingston retained the title. I think this match really did feel the absence of Abraham Washington. But what are you going to do when someone gets fired? Someone gets fired. Will this be the end of the primetime players? Is this a push? I kind of hope not. I think they could use a little bit more fine-tuning as a team. Otherwise, you know, I think they did just fine. No shoehorned matches, no random insertion matches on this one. We went from there to the WWE Championship Triple Threat match. With CM Punk out there sporting the Bret Hart colors and design. Cool on him. Bret Hart tweeted that he had so much respect for CM Punk. That's because he was showing respect to you. It's obvious, you know. CM Punk knows how to butter his bread with the legends. This matchup was about what you'd expect it to be. I was kind of surprised that they had Show working quite as hard as he did. Big Show actually ran most of this matchup and had dominated most of it. Both Punk and Cena barely got much off the ground. And I really felt sorry for the Big Show towards the end of this one, because not only did he tap out to a double submission lock, but then about a minute and a half later, he was pinned by CM Punk for CM Punk to retain the WWE Championship. That's kind of an infamous ending, if you ask me. Overall, I think maybe the decision to just restart the match is kind of sucked. I think they should have just eliminated Big Show and moved on. This matchup gets a B+, because overall, you know, they did really good, and they really worked hard to show the dominance of the Big Show for most of the matchup, and that I gotta give credit to. And I think both John Cena and Punk did very well at selling how dangerous of a man Big Show is supposed to be. So I can appreciate that, and that's what gives it a bumped up rating slightly in my book. We had, from there, I figured we'd have another match, especially as Natalya was going on about what the Divas were going to do and stuff like that. I figured they were like, all right, we're going to shoehorn in one more match before we get the main event with Triple H and Brock Lesnar. No. We get a live musical performance from the guy who did the theme to SummerSlam. What a way to kill the audience's buzz, because the audience was really high and full of energy towards the end of that triple threat match, especially when Punk won, and he was just, you know, the energy was there, and he was rocking, and he was raving up the crowd and showing up respect, and he was having a great old time. The audience was with it and there at that ending point, And the fact that they went into this musical number, which I heard people booing during the musical number a little bit. In the end, they the musician got the polite quarter of the audience applauding him. That really was just a buzzkill. And while there was a decent pop for when Brock Lesnar came out and Triple H came out, the audience wasn't really into this matchup. And not to say that it was a bad match. I think as far as it worked, it was a better worked and better built match than Brock Lesnar versus Cena. Brock Lesnar versus Cena was Lesnar beating the high holy fuck out of Cena for 15 minutes and then Super Cena coming back out of nowhere and getting the win. This match actually had a formula and a design to it. It had an ebb and flow. Brock Lesnar selling up his stomach injury with the shot to the corner of the table was kind of comedic. I found myself laughing at it. Almost as much as I was laughing at Justin Roberts doing the Macarena in the middle of the SummerSlam performer. I don't know. This matchup at least had the proper ebb and flow and was a better match overall. My main problem with it that I found was, one, when Lesnar sold, it did come across a little silly. I think he's forgotten how to sell, and of course he never really sold much to begin with during the 3 years he was in the WWE prior. And also, the other issue I found was that he was, I understand that he was trying to take out Triple H's bad arm and trying to lock in the Kimura lock, and he had it on pretty much a good fourth to a third of the matchup. And I think that was where it was bothering me, is this almost started to feel like the Scott Steiner belly-to-belly fest from 2002. Frankly, I was glad when he broke away from that and we started to get some more variety in the moves, and he was working the arm without just trying to hook on the Kimura and nothing else. That at least felt like a real match. And once they started doing that, the ebb and flow went really well. And I liked how Triple H, hit a second, two pedigrees, and just as he was about to get the second pinfall off the second one, Brock quickly turns it into the Kimura lock, locks it in, and Triple H is fighting back, and then Lesnar does the yank up and pull like he broke his arm again, and Triple H taps out, making my final score for this one a 5-3, I was pretty good at predicting out most of what happened. My only real mistakes on this one were Daniel Bryan. I predicted Miz to lose by DQ or count out, and then of course I had predicted Triple H to win. Overall, I have to give this match also A-, bordering on an A. With the build that they had and the story that they told in the ring, despite the rather flat audience who I think got burned out from some really quality a couple quality matches earlier, as well as having to listen to just a really shitty live performance from a mediocre musician, I can say that that detrimented it, but not enough that it wasn't a good match. And certainly it was a lot more believable than Lesnar-Cena was. Finals overall score for SummerSlam. I'm going to give SummerSlam a B. It wasn't terrible, but it wasn't utterly mediocre either. It had signs of promise. Even matches that I wasn't looking forward to had signs of promise. I think the issue was that there wasn't enough attention given to some of the matches that they had. The ending of the pay-per-view felt a little forced, and what I mean by that is, the Triple H putting on the Mick Foley I'm saying goodbye eyes, and maybe this is Triple H's last match, I don't know. It had that last match feel to it. Which, if this is how Triple H goes out, I suppose that's all well and good. What they say, everybody goes out on their stomachs, on their backs, or whatever the hell it was when he was in the submission lock there, where he looked like he was putting it in Brock Lesnar's ass. We're not going to go into that. Overall, I think the audience also was a little confused, because at first they were mocking Triple H, chanting, "You tapped out." And then when Triple H got all sad-faced and started saying, "I'm sorry, I'm so sorry" to everybody, all of a sudden they started chanting Triple H, Triple H, and thank you, and applauding him, and blah-de-blah-de-blah-de-blah. Typical LA. Backbiters, backstabbers, and probably stoned off their asses. Well, SummerSlam has come and gone. For one of the big four, it at least lived up mostly to the hype. Also considering that overall on the pay-per-view probably looked as a, on paper, mediocre at best, I wasn't too disappointed. Let me know what you thought of it. Comment down below. Maybe you agree with me, maybe you disagree with me. Maybe I forgot a match because I still feel like I did. I'm not sure. Let's see. U.S. title. Jericho Ziggler. Brian Kane. The Intercontinental title match. The tag title. The world title match. The tag title match. And then the WWE title match. Yeah, no, I got them all. Okay. You know, I always have to be sure. You know how it is. Especially when you try to remember 3 hours worth of crap. I'm Mr. Spiffy, and this barrel's been scraped clean. Feel free to follow me on Twitter, at Mr. Spiffy. And feel free to video out. Let me know what you think. And I will probably see you tomorrow with Monday Night Raw. I hope Monday Night Raw is good. Sometimes these after-pay-per-view ones are entirely predictable. Stupid. 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 Stupid.